As always, the next comment comes from Claire on a Futhark Friday, where we were talking about Feihu, which the Futhark Friday will be coming back hopefully soon, and hopefully I will be able to do a couple pre-planned videos, that way they can get posted while I am on my in my vagabond phase of going between here and Florida and visiting people and whatnot. Maybe I can get them pre-posted and released in, on certain days and whatnot. Anyway, hopefully I can get around to shooting those videos, writing up the blog posts and all that. So, yeah. Anyway, going on from that, Claire wrote on a Futhark Friday video, "Those little flash type cards are awesome. Where could I get them?" There is a website, but I would probably suggest not getting necessarily those. There is one that I believe Sunshine Morning Ray has that if I can find or remember the flashcards that she got, they have kind of two decks of the runes. One is a flashcard where it has the meanings on the back and the picture of the rune on the front, and the other deck is just the runes with a regular back, like almost like a tarot deck, where you can use them like a tarot deck. I am also thinking about doing my own type of cards, rune cards like that. So if you are interested in that, that might be something that I will do in the near future. It shouldn't take too much for me to get something like that up and going. Maybe put a little blurb on the back. I don't know. Still rattling it around in the back of my mind. So if you're interested in something like that, maybe that's something I can expedite and put towards the front of the line. So it is accessible during the Futhark Friday series. So if that is something that you want, let me know, and I will come up with something better than these flashcards that I have. Not saying that they're terrible flashcards, it's just they're probably not the best, seeing that I can usually find at least one definition that doesn't fit in with the traditional meanings of the runes. So for me, it's not exactly a terrible purchase for me because they only cost a few bucks, but if you want a good set of flashcards, we're going to get you a good set of flashcards. So don't waste your money on that one. I would rather you have a good set of flashcards that actually have some good meaning behind them rather than one that is just kind of half-assed put together, I guess. So if you want something like that, do tell me and I will get to working on that. The next one I have three by Autumn Fay, and these are on the 77 Witchy Community Tags, parts 1, 3, and 7. So, I'm gonna try to do all of these at once, and hopefully I can, not go hoarse in this video by the end. So, Autumn Fay writes, "First off, I did sit and watch all 7 of the videos successfully. It didn't seem long, but I didn't have to cook dinner, so I had the time." She goes on to say, "Next, I get the feeling that you would very much enjoy studying Zohar and Jewish Kabbalah." I'm going to stop right there. I have studied very little of the Kabbalah. I've gotten at least two books that deal with the Kabbalah. The one I have in storage, the other one I have with me, and I will say both of them I didn't really get into that far because it does get very confusing at points for me. But I recently did pick up my Modern Magic by Donald Michael Craig. I do suggest this book. This one here has 12 lessons of high magical arts. To let you guys know a little bit about this, it is ceremonial magic. It is more ritual based, which for the longest time I haven't been into. I know in the early parts of my practice I was very into ceremonial magic because of the structure, and then I fell away from ceremonial magic to more of the I don't even know what you would call it. Maybe the Appalachian type of magic, I guess you would say. I wouldn't even classify it as that. But anyway, I got more away from ceremonial magic, and now I'm getting more interested in ceremonial magic. So it's come kind of full circle. I was not ready to read about Kabbalah and understand it to the extent that I am now. Knowing what I know now, going back to Kabbalah, and studying that type of stuff makes more sense now than what it did originally whenever I started studying it. So that is something that I'm looking into more and more. So she goes on to say, a good resource is to start with KabbalahCenter.com. It really goes into Jewish mysticism, and you will find, as I did, that the true roots of Judeo-Christian faith are not as different from pagan beliefs as mainstream Christianity would have you believe. I agree. Also, there is a philosophy in biblical scripture that most people are completely unaware of, and it has to do with the regathering of the scattered 12 tribes. Judah, the Jewish people, are only one of the tribes. I have a strong feeling that it is something you would very much enjoy discovering which tribe you are from. The prophecy is known as the Greater Exodus. I feel like many of us are from the tribe of Dan, since the tribe migrated all the way into Ireland and Scotland, and a lot of pagans feel a connection there. You are absolutely correct. I am very interested in this prophecy, and I love doing my genealogy, my family history, and whatnot, so I would very much be interested in finding out which tribe I do or do not descend from. I do have family roots that come from Ireland. I have family roots that come from Wales. I have family roots that come from Syria in the Middle East. So I have family roots that come from all over the European Middle Eastern areas. I haven't found any that come from Asian areas though. So, yeah. Anyway, that is something that I'm very interested in finding out. And yeah, hopefully I will find that out one day. She commented on part three, saying, are you talking about Sumerian deities or something different? If by Syria and the Middle East you mean ancient Samaria, then the works of Zachariah Sitchin, I think is how you pronounce that, is where you can start. Thank you for that suggestion. I will definitely look that up. Anything by this author, I will look up. Hopefully there is something on audible.com that I can go ahead and find and purchase before leaving Korea, so I have something to listen to on the plane. If not, I have other books that I will be listening to on the plane, and whenever my self-imposed book buying ban is over, maybe I can find some of these books and read up on that. So thank you for the suggestion, and I will look into those. Until then, it might just be saved as a wish list book on Amazon. So anyway, moving on. This was also on part three. As far as organizing and displaying essential oils goes, try a nail polish rack. There are certain kinds that hang on the wall and they hold the little bottles perfectly. Thank you. I wanted to include this in there because I know there are other people that have essential oils that find it hard to really display them so you can see them and know which ones you have and don't have and, where they're all at. So thank you for that suggestion. I will definitely be looking into that. Going on from there, she also says in part one, check out Stasha Erickson on YouTube and her Etsy store. There should be a link on her YouTube. She does amazing past life readings. I've done two, and she really has a talent, or really has a gift, I'm sorry. Again, with past life readings, I'm kind of fearful of knowing my past lives because I can get so obsessed with history and whatnot that it might influence my present life. And I think that would be counterproductive to my present life, going and reconnecting with a past life. I think if not done properly for me, it would be kind of an obsessive thing. So I do want to be careful on that. The next comment is from Claire, who comments on the Where You Come From video, where I talked about genealogy. And Claire writes, great video, Rich. So much of my family are screwed up individuals, so I'm in a funny situation of being drawn to knowing my roots and at the same time feeling repulsed by my roots, by the roots that I do see. I want to go on Ancestry.com, but at the moment, as a student with a part-time job that pays crap, I cannot afford the international account for 1 year, which is what I need, as I used the British one before, but it only got me back so far. I might do the whole Ancestry.com mouth swab. Couple things in this one. One, I totally want to do the mouth swab too, the little spit test or whatever, the DNA test. I meant to do it as a Christmas gift to myself. I usually give myself my own birthday gift or Christmas gift or holiday gift, Yule gift, whatever the heck you want to call it, whatever holiday you want to attach to it or not attach to it. I usually gift myself with something once a year, and it's usually around my birthday. And that was going to be this year's birthday gift, but monetarily I couldn't swing it as of right now. So it's going to be a belated gift to myself. But yes, I do want to do the whole DNA test through Ancestry.com because I do have a membership to that. So yeah, I do pay for Ancestry.com. And one thing I will say is if you reach a point with the British version or... I'm not sure what you're saying where you have to pay for the international version, but if you're in the UK, I think they have the UK version where that's all you have to buy is the UK version. I'm not sure how it works overseas, and I'm sorry that I don't know that. But one thing I would suggest is if you get in contact with people that live in the areas that you want to know more about or where your ancestors may have stayed, there are some organizations around those areas that will actually do the research for you for a small price. Sometimes they do it for free because they like to contribute more to other groups or to the world at large or the genealogy community. So that might be something that you want to get a little bit more interested in. And in terms of genealogy, is getting involved in different organizations out there that will help you do your research. Also with Ancestry.com, you can look up all this stuff for free, but actually viewing the records is what really costs you. It's free to set up a tree and all that stuff, but looking up the records themselves and looking at the records themselves is what you pay for. With that being said, if you live near the archives where the records are kept, you can make a day trip, go and view the records in person. And if that's what you're talking about where you can't afford the membership itself, if you live near there, you can always go and visit the library or visit the archive where the records are kept. Also, keep in mind that if your library does interlibrary loan with different family history centers and whatnot, you can also get records that way. So if you guys want me to do a video on genealogy and stuff like that, I can always do those down the road. I love talking about genealogy. Another point that I want to make with working with ancestors is sometimes it's better working with the dead than it is working with the living. The dead, at least with me and working with my ancestors and whatnot, they have a little bit more of an understanding of a full world view than some of them did whenever they were living. And, you know, they accept things a little bit easier in death than they did in life. You know, they don't change automatically, and, you know, it's not like, you know, they're a totally different person, but... You know, so let's say, for example, that you have a relative that is totally against one religion. And, you know, for years they, you know, said this religion was terrible, you know, blah, 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 blah. In death, I think their mind is a little bit more open, they're a little bit more accepting, that, you know, and it is a gradual line. I probably wouldn't personally work with them as somebody that needs to have relatives that are in an open-mindedness, but I would definitely say that, you know, after a certain amount of time, they may have a broader worldview than what they had in their lifetime. I also want to point out that the further that you go back and you start remembering people, the more they're actually going to probably want to work with you. For instance, if I wanted to be more creative and I wanted to do things in a more creative way, I would probably call on my two greats grandmother and her family. You know, even the ones that I'm not directly descended from. I would probably call on her because her family was from Holland and they had a lot of talent. The brother was, he was a playwright, he was a published playwright, he worked in New York, he was a playwright, and he was part of a drama society or something like that. And I have all the news clips from, you know, the drama society's work that they did. I have news clips on who he was and when he published stuff and, you know, different plays that he did. I have news clips on that. I have news clips from their sister, who was a celloist. And I have news clips of my so many great-grandmother, who was an artist, a painter. And she has some fantastic work out there that I would really like to get to see. Now, I say this because if I wanted to be more artistic, these are the people that I would call on to help me be more artistic. And while they may not approve, at least in their lifetime, they may not have approved of witchcraft or anything like that, paying homage to them, as well as, you know, their time being on the other side and seeing things with a broader worldview, within the last 100 years, they're probably more accepting now than what they were back then. I hope this makes sense the way I'm saying it, but the thing I want to point out is certain family members, whenever you call on them for certain things, they're going to be willing to help you, such as being creative and, you know, calling on creative family members. So, not focusing on the bad fruits of the family, but more so focusing on the ones that did live good lives and can contribute to what you're working on, those are the ones that I would focus on the most. I certainly have some bad apples in my family tree, but, you know, I don't need to work with them. This one is on one of the Christo-Paganism series videos, and it comes from T. How do you reconcile your believing in Christ and being a witch? I am really interested in witchcraft, but I do follow Christ, and I feel awful whenever I try to mix the two, like I'm betraying God or something. I know it sounds silly, but I'm curious how you put the two together when so many people insist that they don't go together. And this is something that I'm going to cover in greater detail in a different video, because this is a question that I get time and time again. It's not always easy, and for me, I have to look at the facts of what is biblical fact and what is biblical fiction and what has been changed from one translation to another, and who changed it and what was their motivation. Was it an accident or was it on purpose? These are things that you need to look at least in my perspective, things that you need to look at whenever you're dealing with something so old as the Bible. Focusing on Christ as a morally upstanding person that lived a great life, and in some aspects could be argued that he performed witchcraft in healing people and Some have even said that he performed Reiki, and that was how he healed people. And I don't think that's necessarily out of the realm of possibility. I think that's very possible. So, focusing on stuff like that, focusing on the good rather than the bad parts of Christianity that have been bastardized from, you know, generation to generation, I think it's easier to see that, you know, Christ isn't necessarily against being a witch. Also, like I said, I'm gonna do a whole nother video on just the changes that the Bible has gone through, but I need to get more information together and write it out more in a coherent way. It's not exactly a video that I do on the fly. Okay.